is a battlefield. Man and machine locked in deadly combat. 1 second a pilot's the predator, next the prey. His gut instincts will determine if he lives or dies. From early biplanes to advanced jets, from machine guns to missiles, using state-of-the-art computer animation, you're in the cockpit with history's greatest aces. Experience the battle, dissect the tactics, relive the dogfights. Fighter planes patrol hostile skies. At any moment, an enemy fighter can attack. The pilots have seconds to react. Seconds to live or become a fireball.
I liken it to gladiator work. These are fights to the death. And it only ends when you kill him, he kills you. And they're vicious, violent. They end in a big explosion, a lot of fire, the planes burn. That's what it's about.
Living or dying depends on winning or losing. And you win and you live.
It was a game, in a way. It was the world's most dangerous game.
The first time you are at the controls by yourself and depart Mother Earth, you're changed forever. Forever.
Supersonic jets. Laser-guided missiles. Computer-enhanced controls that fuse pilot and plane into one deadly entity. These are the tools of modern dogfighting. But the tactics were born in an era of canvas, wood, and wire. 1914, the dawn of World War I, only a decade since the invention of flight. The war is fought on the ground and sea, and for the first time in the air. Aircraft are new. Small, slow, and fragile, they're used to observe enemy movements. Soon, pilots begin shooting at each other.
Manfred von Richthofen, the famous Red Baron, his first two kills were, I believe, from the back seat with a shotgun. They said, though, there's got to be a better way. They mounted a machine gun back there.
But the ideal place for guns is in the front of the aircraft. The pilot aims his plane and pulls the trigger. There's no way to synchronize the firing of the machine gun with the propeller. Pilots are shooting off their own props. By the fall of 1915, Dutch aircraft designer Anton Fokker, working with the Germans, revolutionizes the air war with a new invention.
The interrupter gear would set forth a series of lever movements. It would prevent the machine gun from firing when the propeller was right in front of the machine gun.
It's a huge success. The Germans create the first true fighter plane. The Allies find a downed German fighter with the interrupter gear intact and copy it. The skies become a killing field.
In the early days of fighter aviation were pretty colorful. One in four of the fighter pilots didn't survive training. It was a high casualty business back in the early days.
The deadliest warriors who get five kills earn a new title, the Ace.
Only one pilot out of 20 becomes an ace, meets that magic five victory mark.
But there are no established rules. It's trial and error means certain death. The average lifespan for a new pilot is 3 weeks.
These men were very, very brave men. The aircraft could disintegrate. The airplane could just catch on fire. The airplanes had no brakes, no oxygen.
They didn't have parachutes. If the airplane was put out of action, they went down with it because there's no way to get out.
By September 1916, leading German ace Oswald Boelcke publishes the Doctrine for Air Combat,
His eight rules are in a manual called Dicta Boca. Rule one, keep the sun behind you to conceal your position. Rule two, follow through on your attack. If you run, you're an easy target. Rule three, fire only at close range to ensure hits and save ammunition. Rule four, keep your eye on your opponent. Watch out for tricks. Rule five, attack from behind, the vulnerable 6 o'clock. Rule six, if attacked, turn into your opponent. Force him on the defensive. Rule seven, in enemy skies, keep your line of retreat. Rule eight, attack in groups with each plane targeting his own opponent. Pilots on both sides learn these rules quickly or die. In 1917, America enters the war without a fighter plane advanced enough for combat. They use French aircraft, like the powerful Spad 13. Among the Americans is a world-famous daredevil race car driver named Eddie Rickenbacker.
I went over with Pershing as a staff driver with the original contingent that went to World War I.
Eager for action, he's quickly transferred to flight school.
There are natural pilots and there are mechanical pilots. And there are those who are sort of in between. He was natural.
Rickenbacker wins his first victory on April 29, 1918. By September, he's America's top-scoring fighter pilot with 8 kills, making him the ace of aces.
He had a tremendous desire to be the leading ace and to fly fighters, and he knew he could do it.
But the title Ace of Aces historically brought two things, fame and death. Captain Rickenbacker wrote, "The possession of this title brought with it unavoidable doom that had overtaken all previous holders. I began to feel this superstition was the heaviest burden I carried into the air, but I never could forget the life of a title holder is short." On September 24, 1918, Rickenbacker takes command of the famous 94th Aero Squadron. The Hat in the Ring Squadron scores nearly 70 kills during the war, more than any other American fighter group. Rickenbacker promises his men that he'll lead by example. At dawn the next morning, September 25th, he takes off alone in his Spad 13 to keep that promise. Now, you're in the cockpit with Eddie Rickenbacker, heading into his legendary dogfight, relived for the first time in state-of-the-art computer animation. At first, Rickenbacker has the sky to himself. Then he spots two large specks below in the distance. They're two German LVG observation planes, perfect targets. But they're not alone. Slightly behind and 1,000 feet above the LVGs are 5 lethal Fokker D-7 fighters.
The Fokker D-7, without a doubt, was the best fighter plane of World War I. It had a very strong engine. It had low maintenance problems. The Spad was a very good aircraft, too. Very sturdy, and it was really great in a dive.
Rickenbacker's Spad is faster than the German Fokker. The two planes are equally armed, but the Fokker is more maneuverable. Facing 7-to-1 odds, most pilots would cut and run. Not Rickenbacker. He climbs, following Boelcke's first rule.
He comes out of the sun, that's important. He has the sun to his back and they can't see him.
As the enemy formation passes, Rickenbacker idles his engine. It allows him to attack silently and eliminates the vibration from the engine that's so violent it can ruin the pilot's aim. Rickenbacker noses down in a steep dive.
He realizes that he has a chance to attack from the rear quarter. He chooses to pursue his attack on the tail end Charlie, or that last fighting aircraft, that Fokker.
Rickenbacker employs Boelke's fifth rule, attack the exposed 6 o'clock. The Fokker spots Rickenbacker. Too late. Rickenbacker opens fire with his two Vickers 30 caliber machine guns. The four remaining Fokkers, stunned at Rickenbacker's sudden attack, scatter. They know they've been attacked, but not from where or by how many. It'll take them time to discover there's only one enemy. Time for their leader, with no radio and only hand signals, to reform the group.
So he realizes now they're no longer going to be a factor to him. So he then chooses to go ahead and continue on to attack those reconnaissance aircraft.
As the Fokkers splinter, they leave the LVGs unprotected. The LVGs spot Rickenbacker and make a run for it. They dive for safety. The planes draw apart. The rear gunners fire, but Rickenbacker is out of range. Rickenbacker dives to get out of the line of fire. His dive takes him under the Germans. He zooms up to attack the nearest plane's vulnerable belly. The nearest LVG kicks his tail around, giving his gunner a clear shot at Rickenbacker. Then the second LVG steals in on Rickenbacker's tail, spitting a deadly stream of machine gun bullets at his SPAD. Rickenbacker's caught in lethal crossfire and in grave danger. 25th, 1918. American ace Eddie Rickenbacker, behind enemy lines, has attacked 7 German aircraft. He's taken out one Fokker, causing the fighter escort to splinter. He presses his attack on 2 heavily armed LVG observation planes. The 4 remaining Fokkers are still trying to regroup. As the LVGs fire, tracer bullets streak past Rickenbacker's cockpit.
So now, Captain Rickenbacker has to find a way to maneuver his aircraft and put to a position where the LVGs can't shoot. It's pretty tough.
Rickenbacker zooms upward to gain altitude and get out of range. Then he rolls over and dives down to attack the nearest LVG. The LVG carries a 7.92mm Parabellum machine gun. It can fire 700 rounds per minute, 200 rounds faster than the SPAD or the Fokker, giving the LVG a greater chance to hit its mark.
These two-seaters were very, very dangerous. They were as dangerous as a single-seater Fokker.
The fire of the LVGs thwart one attack. Rickenbacker, ignoring the danger, repeats his tactic and dives under the LVG to set up his attack and get out of the line of fire. He climbs to strike the LVG's vulnerable belly, but the LVG's heavy crossfire forces him to roll over the top and dive to attack again. The Germans are expert warriors.
The Germans were particularly skilled in the dogfight. You just didn't realize the environment you were getting into.
Most of their fighter pilots had extensive experience flying two-seaters on the Russian front. As you also might expect, the Germans saw fighting as a duty.
The World War I German pilots were very effective, amazing amount of kills. They were fighting over their homeland. They actually started teaching tactics. I'd imagine that's part of the reason why they became so effective.
The LVG again sideslips, allowing the rear gunner a clean shot at Rickenbacker. Again, Rickenbacker is forced to climb, roll, and dive for another assault. But the Germans pull the same defense, and Rickenbacker is caught in the crossfire. Then, the LVGs suddenly, inexplicably, make a fatal mistake.
On the fourth pass, for reasons which no one will ever know, the two LVGs separated and gave him some space.
Out of the crossfire, Rickenbacker uses the opening to attack the nearest LVG. The Fokker escorts have regrouped and tear to the rescue of the surviving LVG. Rickenbacker sees the Fokkers diving toward him and decides two kills is enough.
The four Fokker D-7s did not follow him. That's not unusual for either side to say the fight is over and we've had enough.
He has faced 7-1 odds, destroyed two of the enemy, and escaped to fight again.
I came out of World War I without a single scratch. There were more than 150, I would say 160 encounters with the enemy, out of which I got 26 victories.
His action of September 25th will win him the Congressional Medal of Honor.
I knew that I wanted to be like him. He was my knight in shining armor from the time I was about 8 years old.
Rickenbacker writes, "Courage is doing what you're afraid to do. There can be no courage unless you're scared."
I interviewed a World War I ace, a guy who was 92, and I asked him one time, I said, "You ever get nightmares?" He said, "Yeah, I do." I said, "When was the last time you had one?" He said, "Last night." And I thought they'd kind of fade away with time, but they don't.
The tactics pioneered by the pilots of World War I stand the test of time and the march of technology.
No matter how advanced their weapon systems or aircraft become, the tactics that Rickenbacker and Boelke and those guys developed in World War I are still applicable today.
By World War II, just over 20 years later, the fighter has evolved into a powerful weapon more than 300 miles per hour faster than the SPAD.
The changes between World War I fighters and World War II was power. We now have aircraft that have more horsepower. They can go faster, they can go higher. They also carry better weapon systems.
They carry more guns with longer range, more ammo, and a bigger punch than the SPAD's two 30 caliber machine guns. Faster planes and deadlier weapons mean less time to react, less margin for error. The skies of the Second World War will be far more lethal than the first. Since 1943, the Americans have sent massive daylight bombing raids into the heart of Germany, beyond the range of fighter escort. The heavily armed bombers are expected to defend themselves against swarms of enemy fighters.
The daylight raids proved to be quite unsuccessful, and we suffered some heavy losses, losing as many as almost 60 bombers during one mission.
The losses mounted. September 6th, 1943. 45 B-17s destroyed. October 14, 1943, 65 B-17s destroyed by 1,100 German fighters. The Air Force called it Black Thursday.
600 men went down on that day, and it almost put an end to the daylight bombing. They said, "Now we gotta have fighter escort. Well, we just can't do this without it."
By late 1943, the Allies finally have a fighter with a range of over 1,300 miles, enough to escort the bombers deep into Germany, the P-51 Mustang. Starting in December 1943, they begin guarding the bombers, forcing the Luftwaffe to dogfight over its own skies. May 27, 1944. American B-17s take off from bases in southern England. Soon, they're in the skies over France. The mission? Destroy Nazi synthetic fuel factories in Germany. The huge formation is escorted by the P-51 Mustangs. Leading a group of four Mustangs is Old Crow, piloted by Captain Clarence Bud Anderson.
I can't remember a time when I wasn't interested in flying. I mean, I had that desire to fly as far back as I can remember in my life.
He earned his Air Corps wings in September 1942 and became a fighter pilot. A year later, Anderson headed to England to fight the Luftwaffe. His fighter group, the 357th, will become the first P-51 Mustang unit in the 8th Air Force. Now, you're in the cockpit as four German fighters challenge Bud Anderson in one of the most electrifying dogfights of World War II. May 27, 1944. Bud Anderson's four P-51 Mustangs escort an American bombing mission. Now, relive the dogfight as he faces a flight of deadly German ME-109s. They're two formidable opponents. The P-51 Mustang is one of the Allies' top fighters.
It was a tremendous airplane. It was good at high altitude, good at low altitude. It was very maneuverable. I think in the hands of a good pilot, it could hold its own or do better than any of the enemy airplanes.
The ME-109 entered service in 1937, a favorite of the Luftwaffe. Over 35,000 were produced, more than any other fighter in history.
The strengths of the 109 were that it was a very small but very fast aircraft. It was very difficult to see. It had a very low profile, and it also had a very good zoom rate. It could climb very quickly.
The P-51 is faster and turns tighter. It flies over 3,000 feet higher than the ME-109. But the ME-109 is more heavily armed and is a battle-hardened veteran, as are the men who fly them.
The German pilots had so much more experience and so much more flying time than the Allied fighter aircraft. Some of these pilots have been flying since 1935 and flew into the 40s, and this is one of the reasons why you saw such incredible kill rates, with some of these pilots getting 200 or 300 aerial victories.
Anderson has one advantage that the fighters of World War I lacked. Improvements in electronics now allow planes to carry a radio.
We hear on the radio that up front, ahead of us, they were being attacked. My wingman's on the inside. He calls out, hey, we got four bogies, unidentified airplanes, attacking us, coming down on us from 5 o'clock high. We're very vulnerable.
The opening moves of a dogfight are critical. Anderson can go left, right, straight, climb, or dive. If Bud turns left, he's in the angle of attack. If he goes straight, the Messerschmitt, its dive giving it superior speed, will overtake him. His only hope is to break right. The German is going too fast to make the sharp turn.
So we turn like this very hard.
Bud's flight does a half circle, then goes head on toward the Germans. The two groups pass each other. The Germans turn left, so do the Mustangs. It's a lethal game of hunter and hunted as each side tries to get on the other's vulnerable 6 o'clock.
Now we got four ME-109s. We got four Mustangs coming around. They want to fight. So they're coming around. And we're coming around now in a big left circle. This goes about two times. Each time we come around, I'm a little closer to getting in trail with them. So we've turned their advantage now to our advantage.
Bud is here. The Germans are here. The Mustang's tighter turn gives them an inside track. The smaller turning radius allows the Mustangs to close in. Anderson's plan? Use this advantage to get on the ME-109's tail. Line up, fire.
You do all this stuff by instinct. You don't have it all figured out. You do it instinctively.
The Mustang's 450 caliber machine guns carry nearly 1,300 rounds, but that's just 20 seconds of ammo. Anderson needs to make every shot count.
We were all young, indestructible, I hope. I knew it was a lie, but you had to think that way.
The Germans spot the Mustangs closing the range and make a run for it. But with a top speed of 441 miles per hour, the Mustang is over 50 miles per hour faster than the ME-109. Then one German breaks away from the pack and climbs.
I'm looking at this guy, and I don't want to get too far up or he can drop down on me.
Anderson sends two of his Mustangs, led by Eddie Simpson, after it. Bud and his wingman, John Scarra, stay after the other three ME-109s. Bud uses the Mustang's superior speed and gets within 300 yards of the Messerschmitt.
When you shoot somebody down, the best way to do it is to get right here, what we call 6 o'clock. That's what I did with this guy.
The wounded 109 does something that amazes Anderson. He keeps flying upside down.
And I thought, what the heck's he doing, you know? If he's gonna run away, he just would roll over and pull away. I'm sitting there right side up very comfortably and pump some more shells into him.
It was Anderson's sixth kill of the war. It's now two against two. Bud can tell the Germans are nervous. Their planes twitch as the pilots strain, pulling on the stick as they look over their shoulders. One German dives to escape. The other climbs and turns. He still wants to fight. Clearly, one experienced dogfighter.
When you saw a German airplane, you treated him like the Red Baron. I mean, you used every advantage you had over him, and without the knowledge of knowing who was in that airplane.
Bud tries to follow the ME-109. The German turns a hard left. Bud realizes he's going too fast to make the turn. He passes the German and climbs, trying to gain the advantage. Bud is now above the German. If the German continues to turn, Bud can drop on him. If he dives, Anderson can give chase. But the ME-109 skillfully reverses his turn, pulls a hard right, and gets behind the Mustangs. Bud is in front. His wingman, John Scarra, is right behind. It's now Scarra who has the German on his tail. Anderson tells Scarra to dive, hoping the German will follow.
I'll drop in behind him. Maybe we can get him that way. So John did that. Sure enough, boy, he went right after him.
At over 400 miles per hour, Bud dives after the ME-109 that's still on Scarra's tail.
He sees that right away. He comes and straightens out, pulls away, then he comes around on this hard turn again.
The German has pulled the same maneuver, left turn, hard right. Using Boelke's fifth rule, he's now on Bud's tail.
Now I've got the problem. So I pull the airplane up as steep as I want to, full power, got everything just going as I can. I know that I've got a little more energy than it is, but I'm thinking about plan B.
In Bud's head, he knows that energy, or airspeed, is life. Anderson's in trouble. It's the only time in his Air Force career that an enemy fighter is behind him, almost making a perfect attack.
Here you are, one-on-one, kill or be killed. There's big odds that you might not make it. You might be killed in this thing. And you wonder inside, how am I going to perform personally? Am I going to run or am I going to fight? You don't know. I mean, you can train, but the actual thing is real. It's real.
One hit from the German's 30-millimeter cannon could shred his Mustang. Life or death is seconds away. American ace Bud Anderson has shot down one German fighter. Now, Another ME-109 is tight on his tail. Anderson climbs for his life.
Now I can see that hole in the prop where the big cannon is, and I'm in big trouble if he can get that gun pointed right at me.
The Rheinmetall Borsig Mark 108 cannon fires 650 30-millimeter shells a minute. Its 30-millimeter shell is nearly three times larger than the P-51's 50 caliber. Five hits could knock down a B-17. One hit could rip apart Anderson's Mustang.
I look back there, and man, that thing looked like an elephant gun to me. I'm pulling up. We're both losing airspeed at a pretty significant rate. And pretty soon, one of us is going to stall first, and whoever does that is going to be in big trouble.
When a plane flies straight up, it fights gravity, loses speed, and eventually stalls and drops. If the German stalls first, Bud will dive on his tail. But if Anderson stalls first, he will slip down below the ME-109 and will be blown out of the sky. Both planes soar upward at the edge of their performance. The pilot's adrenaline pumps as they climb for their lives.
He has to lead me. And he's actually below me. I see him pulling, so I'm pulling. We're both pulling.
With the throttle full forward, Bud has maxed his P-51 to the limit. Then, Anderson sees what he's been praying for.
I see the airplane shudder. He's starting to lose control.
The German runs out of airspeed and lift, shudders, stalls, and plummets. 2 seconds later, Anderson's more powerful Mustang shudders, but doesn't stall. He dives down after the German. Anderson has gone from prey to predator. The ME-109 regains control, brakes hard to his left. Anderson decides to go for the kill, but it requires a tricky, dangerous move. The German is here. Anderson is here behind him. The German continues his sharp left turn. Bud tries to follow. If he doesn't make the turn, he'll be in front of the German. Out of speed, a sitting duck. Bud bets his life that his Mustang will make the turn. It does. Anderson is now directly behind the ME-109. Now it's the German who climbs, trying to escape. Anderson knows the Messerschmitt will stall before he does and gets on the German's six.
I start firing right in here, and I saw some tracers go across his right wing a little bit. I pushed a little bit of left rudder, and then pow. I hit him right in the middle, right in the wing root, all around the cockpit and engine area. Tremendous white vapor came out initially.
The German is hit, but his plane is still intact.
And then he just suspended in the air. So close, I can see the wheel well and the rivets and the grease and everything. He just rolls over and goes down. I followed him down through 20,000 feet. I was going faster than I ever been in my life. I was going too fast, and I pulled the throttle back. Well, he was smoking now. He's just black smoke pouring out. It must have been a mile long. And he's just going straight down. I see his shadow. He and his shadow met.
It was a triumphant day for Anderson and the three other Mustangs. Attacked by four enemy aircraft, they broke the attack, then turned the tables, destroying three of the enemy. Of the B-17 bombers dispatched on that mission and escorted by the Mustangs, only 12 were missing. The Germans lost over 34 fighters. The raids on the synthetic fuel factories were a success. In only 2 months, Germany's oil production was cut in half. The Mustang and men like Bud Anderson saved the daylight bombing campaign. They also saved thousands of lives and turned an Allied disaster into victory. As the Germans lose veteran pilots, new, poorly trained replacements become cannon fodder for the Allied fighters. By the end of the war, the Allies decimate the once mighty Luftwaffe and control the sky over Germany. Anderson flew 116 missions in his Old Crow, had 16 and a quarter kills. He never sustained any serious injuries, but some of his squadron mates were not so lucky.
I had a tremendous relationship with the members of my squadron. I thought so much of them that I actually named my son after two of them, and both of them were killed in combat. Jim Browning was one. He later got shot down when he made a head-on pass with a German jet, ME-262, and they collided. Both of them were killed. Eddie Simpson was the other one. He was my wingman.
Anderson would stay in the United States Air Force, serving in post-war Korea and flying combat in Vietnam. He retired in 1972. Chuck Yeager, his friend and squadron mate, calls Bud Anderson the best fighter pilot I ever saw. The piston-engine fighter reaches its zenith in World War II. Even before the war ends, its days are numbered. And the sound of air combat will change forever. Both sides deploy jets near the end of the war, but the German ME-262 is a nasty shock for the Allies. The Germans discover that swept back wings add speed, and its powerful jet engines make it 100 miles per hour faster than the Mustang. Impossible to catch in the air. Fortunately, they are too few and too late to impact the Allied victory. But as the war ends, both East and West realize that jets are the future. Jets are fast, but their engines eat fuel, creating new problems.
One, you were restricted in range compared to your P-51 in War II. Things happen at greater range, faster. Closure rates, turn radius larger.
They accelerate the pace of dogfighting. There's less time to spot the enemy. Closing speed, called merge, is cut in half. Machines can be changed to take the added stress, but the man in the cockpit can't. Extreme high-speed turns create G-forces that push the pilots past human limits.
Someone weighs 200 pounds. A force of 5 Gs would be the equivalent of 1,000 pounds pushing down on them. 7.5 Gs would be equivalent of 1,500 pounds. It feels like it's taking your face and it's stretching it down over your knees, down onto the floor.
The main result of that force is causing the blood to pool in the lower extremities. First thing affected, the eyes. Blood begins to drain out of the eye and begin to lose vision. So someone who is not prepared to handle that quick onset of G can very easily black out and pass out.
The greater speeds require special G-suits to protect the pilots against the extreme pressures of G-forces. Experts predict that the increased speed of the jets and stress on the pilots will make dogfighting obsolete. That theory is soon put to the test. June 1950. Six divisions of the North Korean People's Army swarm across the 38th parallel, the border between North and South Korea. East and West are at war, and for the first time, jets fight jets. Major Frederick Boots Blessé shows he's up to the challenge. He becomes America's leading ace in Korea. Being a fighter pilot has been in Blessé's blood since childhood.
I'd want to be an ace since I first started reading about Eddie Rickenbacker in the 1920s. And that was what I wanted to do. I wanted to go to West Point, I wanted to be a fighter pilot, and then I wanted to be as good a fighter pilot as the Air Force had.
He graduated from West Point in 1945, too late to see combat in World War II. He made up for that in Korea, flying over 200 missions. The goal of many of these missions is simple: kill enemy fighters. Since November 1950, the skies are dominated by a fast, high-climbing opponent, the infamous MiG-15. Some MiGs are flown by hastily trained North Korean and Chinese pilots, but others are secretly flown by Russians. These World War II veterans are well-trained and experienced dogfighters.
The MiG was a formidable opponent because it would do a lot of things that you couldn't do. And the main thing you had to be careful of was not fighting his fight. The MiG had a better climb rate and a better turn rate at 15 and 25,000 feet, and above 25,000, it had about twice the rate of climb as the F-86 did.
The MiG is also heavily armed with a 37-millimeter cannon and two 23-millimeter machine guns. The only American fighter that can match the MiG-15 is the F-86 Sabre. Built by North American Aviation, the same company that created the Mustang, the Sabre draws on captured German research. It's the first swept-wing fighter in the U.S. Armed Forces. The Sabre is armed with six 50-caliber machine guns. While ideal for jet combat, they lack the brute stopping power of the MiG's Russian cannon. The Sabre can dive faster than the MiG and is more stable. Its radar-directed gun sight is more accurate. But the MiG-15 can climb higher and faster and is more heavily armed. October 2nd, 1952. Boots Blasse is in a tight spot. He's over North Korea, 200 miles from his base. His F-86 Sabre low on fuel when he's jumped by a flight of four MiG-15s. Now, enter the cockpit for one of the greatest dogfights of the Korean War. October 2nd, 1952. Major Frederick Boots Blasse leads his 123rd mission. His flight of four F-86s are in a hunting expedition for enemy aircraft over the most hazardous piece of sky in the war, MiG Alley. It stretches from the northeast end of the Yellow Sea along the Yalu River. MiGs dart out from their air bases, attack American bombers, then dash back over the Chinese border. The MiGs have a huge advantage. They are close to their bases. The Sabres are several hundred miles from theirs and carry only enough fuel for 20 minutes over MiG Alley. Blesse and his flight are near the end of their patrol.
We had four guys, and the number four man was the new guy, but the element leader had some problems with his fuel system.
Blasse sends the element leader home, escorted by one of the other Sabres. He keeps the new, inexperienced pilot with him.
Eventually, we got down to the point where we were well into Manchuria and said, okay, it's time to go home.
Flying at 31,000 feet, they turn south, 200 miles from home, with a lot of enemy territory to cross.
We were still well north of Sinuiju in North Korea, and I see four MiGs above me about 8 or 10,000 feet. We didn't have the fuel to fight. We were a hell of a long way from home, and we were really not quite over the water yet. It was not a good position.
Blasse dives to outrun the MiGs. But the lead MiG pilot is clever. Even though he's out of range, he fires, hoping to scare the Americans into making a mistake. The MiG's two 23-millimeter cannon and 37-millimeter gun spit out huge masses of flame. The wingman breaks away from Blasse, turning left.
So as soon as he broke out to the left like that, the two MiGs start cutting him off in the turn.
Blasse's wingman has fallen into the MiG's trap. The MiG cuts inside the Sabre's turn, closing the range.
And I called my wingman and said, put that sucker in a 4G turn and keep it there. And he just started a descending spiral. And the two MiGs are behind him trying to do the same thing.
But the fast turn and defensive spiral make it hard for the MiGs to get a good shot.
and I'm behind those two MiGs. And I looked right after I got into a turn and started on these guys, I took a look to see what the other element was doing, and they're turning in on me. So we had a nifty little daisy chain going down with a 1-2-1-2 deal.
At 18,000 feet, Blessay gets the break he's hoping for. The closest MiG in front of him can't hold the spiral and slides outside the tight turn.
And when he did that, I relaxed the G's on my airplane and lined him up in my gun sight.
In a spiral, G-forces pull on bullets, making it almost impossible to get a clear shot. But Blessay is an expert marksman.
A bunch of stuff flew off of him, some stuff out of the engine puffed, and off he went. He took off.
That leaves the MiG on his wingman's tail unprotected. He rolls away and escapes to avoid becoming Blessay's next victim. But Blessay still has two MiGs on his tail. He orders his wingman to fly home. Rounds from the two remaining MiGs shoot past Blessay's canopy.
I'm in a turn because these guys have just fired over my canopy. I increased the G's and made them slide out to the right. And then I started to reverse my turn.
Boots, using his training and experience, pulls up, reverses into the MiG, then rolls over in a dive. He's now above and behind the MiGs, ready to attack.
And the minute I did that, this guy could see that he was going to be had if he didn't do something. So instead of trying to turn with me, he just rolled into me and headed for the deck, and his wingman went with him.
Blessay lets the MiGs escape. He has no choice.
I didn't want to fight with him. I didn't have the fuel. But now I'm down to about 900 pounds, maybe 1,000 pounds of fuel. I'm damn near 200 miles from home, and I'm already starting to calculate whether I can make it or not.
Blessay climbs to save fuel and reaches 11,000 feet. Then, out of the corner of his eye, it's another MiG on his 10 o'clock, closing fast.
I thought, boy, school is really out. I can't even go one turn with this guy. I don't have the fuel. Above all, I've got to get out over the water.
But Blessay, still over North Korea, is a long way from the Allied-controlled sea. Enemy propaganda broadcasts have singled him out by name. As America's leading ace, he's a sought-after prize.
It hadn't been more than 2 weeks since Pyongyang Sally had been on the shortwave radio, and she said, "Oh, Major Blessay, I see you've got your eighth kill today. But we're going to get you. We're going to get you. And when we do, we're going to hang you from the Han River Bridge."
The MiG, incredibly, doesn't see Blessay's saber, which was low and to his right. Blessay faces a hard choice. The MiG is meat on the table. But if Blessay goes for the kill, he might lack the fuel to get home.
I'm thinking, why does this happen to me? When I go on mission after mission after mission, and I got all kinds of fuel, and I can't find them, and here I am when I don't barely have enough fuel to get to the water, and here's somebody to fight with. I said, "Oh, what the hell? Why not?" And I flipped it over into a turn, pulled up close to him. I came up underneath him and shot him down.
It was his 10th kill, but it cost him 200 pounds of much-needed fuel. Now, alone over enemy territory, Blessay's in trouble. October 2nd, 1952. In the skies over North Korea, Frederick Boots Blessay has just destroyed an enemy MiG, but his fuel tanks are now dangerously low.
I got three alternatives right now. I would like to get all the way home. If that doesn't happen, if the winds are wrong, I don't have enough fuel, maybe I can get to Pangyangdo.
Pangyangdo Island has an Allied radar station and 5,000 feet of hard sandy beach. It's an emergency landing field, but with treacherous risks.
The only problem with it was it had about a 50-foot cliff on each end of the landing strip. But if you're looking at bailing out into the third most shark-infested bay in the world, or maybe taking a crack at that 5,000-foot runway, it doesn't look too bad.
Blessé still hopes to make it to his base in Kempo. He shuts off his engine to save his last dregs of fuel and glides at 180 knots, the Sabre's best glide speed. But within minutes, his Sabre losing altitude and the wind against him, Blessé knows he can't make it back to Kempo or even Pangyangdo Island. His best hope is to eject into the shark-infested sea. Blessé restarts his engine, uses his last drop of fuel, climbs back to 13,000 feet, and heads for the coast. Then, his engine flames out of fuel, well over North Korea.
I got over the coastline. I took a tremendous amount of fire.
Heavy 57-millimeter anti-aircraft fire fills the sky. With no fuel, Blessé can't weave to avoid the ground fire. The flak bursts so close, the air pressure forces his wings up. But he runs the gauntlet and dashes to the sea, crossing the coast at only 3,000 feet. On his radio, one by one, his squadron mates try to keep his spirits up.
This still kind of chokes me up thinking about it. It was a very, very emotional moment for me. I remember after the last guy stopped, I sat there for a full 8 or 10 seconds and I thought, God, what a wonderful, wonderful bunch of guys.
Ejecting from a jet aircraft is extremely hazardous. The sudden G-forces can cause severe spinal injury. Arms and legs not tightly controlled can be severed by the windscreen canopy or cockpit walls. Out of the cockpit, the parachute opening can snap the body again, intensifying injuries. Blessé ejects. He and his seat, with parachute attached, are blown out of the aircraft. Luck is on his side as his parachute unfolds and he safely hits the water. Within 10 minutes, Dumbo, the air-sea rescue flying boat, sweeps down and, as enemy shells fall around them, rescues Blessé. The next day, Boots is at a press conference in Japan, then on his way home with 10 kills as America's top jet ace. By the end of the war, the Air Force had lost 78 Sabres, but shot down 793 MiGs, a kill ratio of 10 to 1. This air supremacy kept Allied ground forces from being pushed into the sea by overwhelming numbers.
We were dominant because we had a bunch of fighter pilots that were very highly experienced, and we had a good airplane, and we were taught ahead of time by our intelligence people what the MiG could do in relation to what we could do. That coupled with hours and hours and hours of dogfighting in the U.S., down in our hearts somewhere, we thought the time is going to come when I can use all this.
In 1955, after the war, Blessé took the hard lessons he learned in Korea and wrote No Guts, No Glory. It became a Bible for fighter pilots. Where Boelcke's dicta laid out fighter combat in broad strokes, No Guts, No Glory gave pilots the in-depth nuts and bolts tactics, the tools of survival and victory.
No Guts, No Glory, great concepts on mutual support, which we still publish today. Basic defensive maneuvers that are put out in that are still applicable today.
Though the Sabre at 679 miles per hour was over 200 miles per hour faster than the World War II P-51 Mustang, they had one thing in common. They both fight with guns. That means getting close to the enemy. But the U.S. Navy, concerned that Soviet bomber attacks can threaten its aircraft carriers, needs a weapon that can destroy the enemy at long range. In the mid-1950s, the rocket-powered Sidewinder missile changes air combat forever. By the Vietnam era, the Sidewinder could accelerate in seconds to a speed of Mach 2.5, over three times faster than most jets. Their heat-seeking sensors can lock in on a target's tailpipe from over 2 miles. Improved missiles like the longer-range Sparrow follow. With the ability to kill far beyond gun range, the experts, as they had with the coming of jets, declare that dogfighting is obsolete.
Why did the experts think dogfighting was obsolete? That really evokes a flood of emotion, memories. Who were the experts, pray tell? People who'd been promoted beyond their capability, way beyond their usefulness, who'd never fought, who looked at manuals, who looked at, I don't know what the hell they looked at.
In the late 1950s and 1960s, dogfight training was minimized. The Navy's new interceptor, the F-4 Phantom, was designed to shoot down Soviet bombers only with long-range missiles.
Remember, the leadership didn't think there was going to be any more dogfights. It was only going to be shooting missiles at a Russian bomber coming across the ocean. So why would you need a gun? The Navy decided not to put a gun in the airplane. Mistake.
Some pilots, like Robin Olds, a World War II ace and future Vietnam commander, pushed for conventional dogfight training.
I was called in to account by my boss, who was a two-star general in the basement of the Pentagon, who very mildly chiding me, "Robin, I'm tired of these staff studies of yours about our lack of conventional capability. Mind you, Colonel, we're never again going to fight a conventional war." And I looked at him and thinking to myself, "General, where have you been since 1945? What do you think we've been doing?"
The American reliance on high tech will face a dangerous and bloody reality. Early in the Vietnam War, the United States wasn't achieving the kind of air superiority it had in past wars.
There was a gentleman by the name of Captain Frank Ault that did a report called the Ault Report, because our senior admiral said, "Why do we shoot so many missiles and not hit anybody? What's going on?"
In 1969, Ault's report made 242 recommendations. There was one that stood out above all others.
He said the problem we're having is the pilots don't know how to dogfight. They've gotten away from the in-close dogfight because we thought the technology was going to dictate that that was no longer a necessity.
In 1969, the Navy establishes Top Gun, the fighter weapons school, to teach pilots dogfighting. Here, fighter crews go through intensive training in air combat maneuvering and weapons systems employment. The 4-week course provides aviators instruction that simulates real combat conditions. The invaluable dogfight training from this school will help earn Randall Cunningham and Willie Driscoll a place in history over the skies of Vietnam. Commissioned into the Navy in 1967, Cunningham's love of John Wayne films and aggressive nature won him the nickname Duke.
I was with Duke Cunningham during the entire combat cruise, and he was 24 hours, 7 days a week. He would just as soon skip lunch and go read up something in the book, very dedicated to his craft. And as I found out in reading up about gentlemen like Oswald Bolke and Manfred von Richthofen, they were the same way.
In 1972, Duke Cunningham is a pilot aboard the USS Constellation, flying the Navy's newest fighter, the F-4 Phantom. The Phantom divides the workload between two men, the pilot and the radar intercept officer, or RIO. Cunningham's RIO is Lieutenant J.G. Willie Irish Driscoll.
The idea behind it was to take some of the burden off the pilot so that he wouldn't have to worry about flying the plane, running the electronic countermeasures, deploying chaff and flares, running the radios, running the radar and all this. At the same time, working together, two sets of eyes and two sets of brains are better than one.
Cunningham and Driscoll train relentlessly together, becoming a formidable fighting team.
We knew each other's tendencies and strengths and weaknesses. We're welded at the hip, as brothers might be, when you go through something like that.
That training will be invaluable. On this day in 1972, they're heavily outnumbered in their F-4 Phantom over North Vietnam by a brutal range of Soviet-built fighters, including the notorious MiG-17. This modernized version of the MiG-15 is a nimble and formidable opponent. At low speed, it can easily outturn the Phantoms.
And the thing that the MiG had was a small airplane, small size, hard to see.
Size wasn't the F-4's only disadvantage.
The F-4, large, bulky, leaves two big smoke trails when it's not an afterburner. Easy to see, therefore, at long distances. Whoever gets visual first has got a much better advantage. In fact, surprise is one of the elements in the combat arena that's historic.
With a top speed of nearly 1,500 miles per hour, the American F-4 Phantom is twice as fast as the MiG-17. Armed with two medium-range Sparrow and four short-range Sidewinder missiles, the F-4 can strike from over 25 miles away. The MiG is more agile than the Phantom, but the F-4 is faster and has a better rate of climb. The MiG's biggest advantage is its armament. In addition to missiles, it also carries short-range guns that the Phantom lacks. May 10, 1972. Randy Cunningham pilots the F-4 Phantom Showtime 100 into the skies of North Vietnam. Now, enter the cockpit and relive one of the most savage dogfights of the jet age. May 10, 1972. Randy Cunningham and Willie Driscoll in the F-4 Showtime 100 are on a 35-plane raid against the Haidong rail yards.
I remember it was a beautiful day, just wispy clouds going through the skies. And you know, as you're climbing in a fighter and you're looking at that armada that you're joining and stuff, it's pretty awesome to look at the power. And at the same time, I'd already lost some good friends. It was deadly serious and earnest, and you didn't want to make mistakes.
Cunningham's Phantom is also armed with bombs for ground attack. The North Vietnamese are determined to shred the strike force. They launch MiGs from five airfields, protecting the rail yards with anti-aircraft guns and surface-to-air missiles, like the SAM SA-2. After dropping the bombs on enemy warehouses, Cunningham and Driscoll loiter to cover the A-7 attack aircraft, the Navy bombers. Cunningham's wingman is Brian Grant.
I told Willie, I said, look at that target we just hit, because we decimated the whole thing. We're secondary explosions. But about that time, Brian Grant spoke up and he said, Dukes, MiG-17's at 7 o'clock.
Two MiG-17s swoop down behind their two Phantoms. Tracers flash by their cockpit. The MiGs are traveling fast. Cunningham knows at top speed the MiG, lacking hydraulic controls like the F-4, is hard to turn.
So I looked at him and I said, no, you can't do it. Broke into him and he overshot right down below me.
But the second MiG, 1,500 feet behind, rolls up to Cunningham's belly. Brian Grant and his Rio, Jerry Sullivan, tell Cunningham they'll take care of the second MiG, leaving Cunningham free to deal with the MiG that overshot him.
I put my nose on him and come through him. I get a Sidewinder tone and squeeze the trigger. The missile literally went up his tailpipe and exploded.
It's Cunningham and Driscoll's third kill of the war. The MiG that had been under Cunningham's belly was still there. Cunningham accelerates, puts on 500 knots, and gets away from the MiG. Having escaped the danger, Cunningham and Driscoll decide to get more MiGs. They pitch up, go over the top, roll out in a maneuver known as an Immelmann turn, named for famed German ace Max Immelmann, and head back to the fight. Below, they see two Phantoms trapped in a wheel of eight circling MiGs and in danger.
MiGs would fly in a wagon wheel, MiG-17, 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 all the way around, and there was eight of them. The tactic that they use, if you get behind one of them, there'll always be a MiG behind you. If you don't get in there with them, you fly tangent to it and you go through and shoot them and then go out the other side and keep your speed up. But in that wheel was two other Phantoms.
As Cunningham starts to head in, an F-4 shoots out of the circle so close they nearly collide. It's Commander Dwight Timm, Cunningham's executive officer, and Timm's Rio, Jim Fox. Timm is here. There's two MiGs on his 5 o'clock, which he sees. But he doesn't see a MiG-17 on his wing, closing in to attack. Cunningham falls in behind and calls for the F-4 in port turn to break away. With Timm's Phantom and the attacking MiG close together, the Sidewinder can't lock on to the enemy plane. If Cunningham fires, the missile could lock on Timm. Cunningham again warns Timm to break right.
He really yelled it out loud, at which point every F-4 out there broke right.
Timm, who'd been focusing on the MiGs at his 5 o'clock, now quickly accelerates. He breaks hard right. The MiG turns, but at this speed can't match the move. Some American pilots, referencing a popular TV show, Gomer Pyle, call the enemy pilots Gomer.
Knowing the enemy's airplane helps because a MiG-17 doesn't have hydraulically boosted controls. It takes a big Gomer in there to pull that pole when he's got all that speed and that G and then nose downhill.
Finally, Cunningham has a clear shot at the MiG. Is Cunningham and Driscoll's fourth kill. Then, four MiG-21s, watching the fight from above, decide to roll in for revenge. The MiG-21 is a fast, agile, and feared opponent.
It'd be stupid to take on a MiG-21 in his best operating envelope, which is higher. He out-accelerates you, out-climb you, and out-turn you. If you don't have the advantage, run, go home, come back the next day. Smart.
Cunningham decides it's time to retreat. He pulls hard and turns in the opposite direction from the MiGs, then heads back to his carrier. Nearing the coast at 10,000 feet, they spot a MiG-17 heading toward them.
I said, Willie, we got a MiG, 12 o'clock. Try and lock him up. He couldn't get a lock. And I said, I'm going to scare the blank out of this MiG. And so I passed right down with full intention, just scaring the heck out of him.
Cunningham's made an almost fatal error.
He started to shoot at us with his gun. We a major mistake passed. We forgot that that's right. They have their gun equipped.
Vertical and roll to try and see him because Hanoi was that way. Any MiG that we ever engaged that hadn't had a real advantage, they'd run.
Cunningham and Driscoll look back, expecting to see the retreating MiG.
Instead of running, he had pulled and gone vertical with me. Now I'm looking at probably 300-400 feet. Close enough I could look in and see a little set of Gomer goggles, little Gomer scarf that he had on his neck, and we're going canopy to canopy with a MiG-17 like this.
Cunningham lights his afterburners and climbs above the MiG. It's his second near-fatal error in minutes. The MiG is now on his six and opens fire.
It was a big mistake. And you know, I was thinking about recovering from it, and, you know, your fangs come out at that point, and your mind says, okay, settle down, dude.
Cunningham rolls off to the side to escape the deadly line of bullets. But the MiG matches his every move.
The only rule was there were no rules. It was a knife fight and a telephone booth.
After all they've been through, Cunningham and Driscoll are still in for the fight of their lives. May 10, 1972. Randy Duke Cunningham and Willie Irish Driscoll have shot down two MiGs in a raid over North Vietnam. Now they're in the enemy's sights. They use all their training and skill, but the MiG-17 on their tail matches them move for move. Cunningham and Driscoll are determined to take the MiG down. But the Red pilot has more than luck. Most North Vietnamese pilots rarely fight in the vertical. They either fight in the horizontal or run. This pilot is different. He has skill, expertise, and a killer's instinct.
I look and I'm looking right at his eyeballs. And I mean, it's like looking at a cobra ready to strike you. And that chill going through your spine, it's every emotion you've ever felt. Fear, hate, anger, love. All of those emotions magnify them 1,000%. And what helps you is that if you panic, then you're vulnerable. And that's where your training kicks back in.
Cunningham and Driscoll set a trap. They nose down to gain speed. The MiG, taking the bait, does the same. Cunningham pulls up, rolls over the top of the MiG, and gets behind him. It's a maneuver called the rolling scissors. Then the MiG uses Cunningham's maneuver and pulls up into him.
I overshot, and then I accelerate again and said, okay, this guy knows what a rolling scissor is.
Each aircraft attempts to roll into his opponent's 6 o'clock. They climb and roll, each fighter trying to get into attack position behind the other.
We're noting that this pilot is flying this plane very well, and he's also handling his weapon system very well, very different from what we've encountered with the other enemy pilots. This fella knew just what he was doing and just how to do it.
As the two jets maneuver, fighting gravity, they lose speed.
It was a three-dimensional rolling fight, and we went through maybe two or three of these rolls. The last time we knew that as we went up to the vertical, we were going to run the risk of stalling or go to zero airspeed, in which case, if he had a little bit more airspeed than us, he was going to be able to kill us.
At low speed, the smaller MiG can outturn the big American jet. This is becoming the MiG's fight.
I don't fight his fight. I don't get into a turning fight with him because that's his fight. I'll force him into the vertical, or I'll force him to do something else that I want. When you set a trap for somebody, you also are cognizant that another good pilot could be setting a trap for you.
Cunningham knows it's time to turn the fight around. He fires his afterburners, dumping raw fuel into his exhaust to gain more speed. And at 600 knots, darts 2 miles away from the MiG, ending the rolling scissors. Cunningham and Driscoll take a second pass at the MiG, this time angled to the side so the MiG can't fire head on. Then Cunningham climbs. So does the MiG, starting another rolling scissors.
He would force me to overshoot, use rudder, kick like this. Very experienced pilot.
As they keep in the rolling scissors, Cunningham loses speed and again risks making it the MiG's fight. Cunningham is furious. The MiG has gained the advantage twice. For the second time, Cunningham hits his afterburners, puts 2 miles between his Phantom and the MiG, then roars back to attack. Cunningham puts his nose up 60 degrees and begins to climb. Again, the MiG follows him. Cunningham tries a trick he learned at Top Gun. He hits his air brake and idles his throttle, slowing down the Phantom. Cunningham knows the MiG is expecting him to overtake and pass, putting the MiG on the Phantom's six. For Cunningham, slowing down is a dangerous move. He could easily stall and lose control of his plane, giving the MiG a huge advantage.
One of the things we always teach at Top Gun is we want our pilots to fly that airplane 1 inch from out of control at all times in a purposeful way. And that's what Duke is doing with this airplane right now.
It works. The MiG shoots out in front and above him.
It's like if you put on your brakes, a car is going to go by you on the highway. That's what I was trying to do to get him.
Finally, Cunningham and Driscoll have the advantage. If Cunningham had a gun, he could blow the MiG out of the sky. But all he has is missiles, and he's too close to use them.
But I made another mistake. I expected that relative motion to keep going like this, but he ran out of speed, and I ended up about 700-800 feet away from him. And I can't shoot him because the missile won't arm at that point unless it just hits him.
The MiG pilot knows he's in desperate trouble and rolls over the top, away from Cunningham and Driscoll. At the top of the roll, he briefly stalls and heads into a dive. He recovers with Cunningham and Driscoll behind him. The MiG heads for the ground, opening the range, but hoping the ground heat will prevent the Sidewinder's heat seeker from locking onto it.
He just kept running. So when he got nose to tail position, about 2,000 feet, I just stood on the rudder like this, pointed the nose at him, and shot him.
It's Cunningham and Driscoll's fifth kill. They later discover that this great adversary may have been the legendary Colonel Toom, widely believed to be North Vietnam's leading ace. But celebrations will have to wait. Cunningham and Driscoll are a long way from home. With more MiGs closing in, they roll out and head for the coast.
And as I rolled, look up, I could just see a SAM coming, an SA-2. It's about the size of a telephone pole.
The SA-2 has a top speed of Mach 3.5, over 2,660 miles per hour. This missile can obliterate jets at 60,000 feet.
The first time you see a surface-to-air missile launched at you, the first time there's heavy anti-aircraft artillery, those are stressful, very stressful times. And even after all of the training, you never really know how you're going to handle that until the bullets are real.
So I saw this SAM, and I just started to break into it, which is lucky I didn't, because if I would have broken, this thing went off, it would have gone right through Willie and I through the cockpit.
Then the SAM explodes nearby.
Sound like someone took 1,000 BBs and threw against, you know, your car. And the airplane kind of shook itself a little bit.
Maybe 15 seconds later, Duke says Willie was starting to lose PC-2. That was one of our main hydraulics. As he said that, I looked back over the left side of the plane. I noticed the left turtleback area of the plane. There's fire on the side of the plane.
The Phantom skids violently to the left. The backup hydraulics fail.
Duke comes back, Willie was down to lose PC-1. PC-2 is going to zero.
Then, a pilot's worst nightmare.
The airplane all of a sudden rolled upside down, out of control. And I remember thinking, the only time I'd ever asked for divine help is when I got in trouble. You know, and I remember thinking, God, I don't want to be a prisoner of war. I don't want to die. Get my rear end out of this.
With the backup hydraulic system gone, Cunningham rolls upside down and tilts the nose up so it won't pitch down. He controls the Phantom with the rudders. They roll nearly 20 times, descending from 27 to 17,000 feet, but speed closer to the sea. To eject over land means becoming a POW. Every second they can keep flying brings them nearer to the coast and rescue. They stay with the plane as fire warnings blare.
You have to get through that and have a firm enough grip on yourself to get done what has to be done at the moment.
The Phantom spins violently downward. Cunningham and Driscoll are over enemy territory, on fire, and going down fast. May 10, 1972 started well for Randy Duke Cunningham and Willie Irish Driscoll. They killed three MiGs, but maybe one fight too many. Wounded by a SAM missile, they spin out of control over North Vietnam.
Now there was a fire about 40 feet behind us, and Willie said, "Duke's getting hot back here." And I could see the fire out the mirrors, and I put the stick and the airplane kind of righted itself, and I remember thinking, God didn't have anything to do with this, it was just my superior flying skills. But about that time, the airplane went back upside down, and I remember thinking, God, I didn't mean it, get me out of here. I rolled the airplane some 30 miles using only rudder and power until the tail actually blew off and the airplane went into a violent spin. Luckily, the radios were knocked out because there are people screaming at us on this tape. And they're saying, get out of that airplane, airplane in the spin over the beach, you know, get out of that airplane. I didn't hear any of that, which I was glad.
Mark, get out of that airplane. Get out of that airplane. It's going down in the spin off the beach.
Finally, they clear the coast.
The plane flipped onto its back. I did pretty much a handstand off the top of the canopy. When he gave me the Willie eject, 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 we have an alternate handle between our legs. That was a struggle to get to it. I just got a couple fingers on it, and they always taught us in training to keep our arms in so we don't break our arms, but I was kind of bent like a pretzel. Pulled it, and then bam, he went off one direction, I went off the other. We had like rockets on the back of the seat, so the rockets fired us out.
325, no DME, about 5 miles off the beach. Okay, stick with those, stick with those.
Moments after they eject, Showtime 100 crashes into the sea. They're quickly rescued. With five kills, Cunningham and Driscoll are the first aces of the Vietnam War. Their squadron, the Fighting Falcons, will have the most air-to-air kills of any Navy unit in Vietnam. Thanks to men like Cunningham and Driscoll, the Americans maintain total air superiority in the Vietnam War, forcing the North Vietnamese Air Force on the defensive. After Vietnam, Cunningham served as an instructor at Top Gun, the Navy Fighter Weapons School. Cunningham retired in 1987 and went on to serve 8 terms as a congressman from San Diego. Driscoll retired in 1988, was asked to join the Navy Reserve in 1990, and is a frequent guest speaker at the Navy's Top Gun School.
That's why Top Gun and the Air Force Fighter Weapons School exists, to help our pilots learn in training what they're going to need to know in combat to keep them alive and protect our country.
Starting in 1973, the Phantom is replaced by the F-14 Tomcat. Because of the lessons learned in Vietnam, the Tomcat is armed with a gun as a fast, nimble dogfighter, as are the later F-15, F-16, and the Navy's F-18 Hornet.
The F-18, for example, can, in a nose-low turn, can sustain 7.5 Gs. An F-4, by comparison, could only, in a situation like that, could sustain maybe 2 to 2.5 Gs. So it's a huge difference in performance ability.
But behind the technology, the basics remain the same.
If we have a missile, great, we can shoot them forward quarter. If we don't, we now have to apply those same concepts that Rickenbacker did and work ourselves behind him in the ability of shooting with our gun.
Modern fighters are also armed with the deadly 20mm Vulcan rotary cannon. It's a far cry from the 600 rounds per minute Vickers machine guns that forced Eddie Rickenbacker to close within 100 yards of his target. In the future, fighters like the F-22 Raptor will combine even greater maneuverability with higher sustained speeds and stealth technology that will render it nearly invisible to enemy sensors. The dogfight is one of war's most intense forms of combat.
There were so many times where a second here or there could have meant life or death.
Here's another scene that I think encapsulates what it's like to be a fighter pilot. When he sees the enemy, he attacks and kills. Anything else is rubbish. That was spoken by Baron von Richthofen in 1916.
If you get a little bit sloppy, a little bit careless, or if you don't remember and employ all of the things that you've learned, all of the procedures, all of the techniques, you can die very quickly.
The progress from World War I to the present is staggering. The SPAD 13 had a top speed of 130 miles per hour. The F-18 can hit 1,500. With aerial refueling, modern fighters have an almost unlimited range. Long-range modern sensors and missiles can strike to the horizon. But relying on high tech can be a fatal mistake.
Radars go out, pilots make mistakes, missiles don't work. All kinds of things can happen during the mission to keep you from getting the kill that you think you're going to get at 25 miles and you don't get it at all.
Of the few who become fighter pilots, fewer still become aces.
I had gotten my fifth kill. I was now officially an ace, and I remember it made such an impression on me. While I was climbing out, I said, please God, I know that you may have to take me before I get through this whole mess over here, but let me get home. Let me get home and tell somebody that I got my fifth kill and became an ace.
Manfred von Richthofen had 80 kills. Thomas B. McGuire with the United States Air Force had 38. Otto Kittel had 267. Now, all of these aces were successful because they applied tactics and techniques that were based on their strengths and their enemy's weaknesses. They took the fight to the enemy and fought on their own terms. But keep in mind, they also had one other thing in common. They were all killed in 1v1 air combat. You can't afford to let your guard down, and by no means should you ever go against your own recommendations or your own techniques.
You go beyond, you're going to lose the fight and possibly kill yourself and someone else.
What does make the difference between a great fighter pilot and a good fighter pilot? Call it a fighting spirit. You had to want to do it. You had to want to go up there every day and do it.
Dogfighting's obituary has been written time and again, and is always premature.
I just don't ever see our country being in a position to not need a courageous, gutsy fighter pilot to do the job when the job needs to be done.
If the pilot is well trained, aggressive, and has the will to win, he'll survive the ultimate test of air combat, the dogfight.